Thank you. Thanks a lot for the invitation. So I'm going to talk about sensor in oncology, not a field I'm a specialist of, but I would like to share a few ideas on the questions with you on this subject. I define myself as a computational oncologist working in a comprehensive cancer center in Paris, La Cité Curie, which covers fundamental, translational, and clinical research, and patient treatment, cancer patient treatment. First, a few figures about cancer. Today, cancer is about 14 million new cases per year and 8 million deaths. Just. And if you look at the figures, the incidence is increasing. It seems long, but it's continuously increasing. It's supposed to double, it's predicted to double within the next 15 years. And mortality is decreasing. But this picture is very contrasted between countries and between cancer types. So how does it arise, cancer? Well, we all know that it's more or less the accumulation of gene mutations, of random gene mutations, which will trigger some, allow some cells to proliferate faster than others, and then the random on the tumor can arise this way. Since it's random, there is no two identical tumors. It's a personal disease. You do not have the same tumor as your neighbor. And it also affects many different cell processes. So in mathematical terms, the complexity of the disease is really, really very high. So how do we treat cancer? For long, there have been several strategies which have been developed, and they can fall into many different categories, which I've listed here. And the important things to notice is that none of these categories, none of them has invalidated the previous one. So we still use all of these different approaches in the treatment of cancer, despite recent innovation. And the question I will try to answer, or I will try to explore, is what a sensor-based strategy can bring to this situation. The first thing the question to ask is how we should approach this question of treating the problem of cancer. And the first question is, should we focus our attention on cure or on prevention? And this figure, you have the drawing, the most effective strategy for decreasing the number of cancer deaths in the case of lung cancer was has been to fight against the risk factors and not to develop better drugs. We have failed in developing good drugs against lung cancer, we will say that, but prevention was very, very efficient. So that's an important thing to keep in mind. And probably that is something which is quite general to many cancers. Here I listed for a lot of cancer, bladder carcinoma, the list of known risk factors for this cancer, and smoking is again, one of the main risk factors. We are three times more likely to develop cancer if you smoke. There are many other types of risk factors. Some of them are linked to genetics, like personal and family history. And many of them are linked to the exposure to chemical toxic factors, to parasites, or also to life habits. But in broad terms, we can say that most of them are linked to environment. So that's the main factor behind cancer. And the main cause of cancer is environment. And the main way to combat cancer is to use this environmental information to improve our treatment of cancer. Plus, of course, the family history and the genetic of cancer. And if you look at what sensor can measure today, as we have seen yesterday, it can measure many parameters which are linked to the patient itself, like blood, heart, sweat, breast, and so on, and also many other parameters which are linked to the environment, like composition of air, water, soil, and so on, and many others. And what's important is that many of these parameters measured by sensor are either directly or indirectly linked to cancer risk factors. And by combining simple things like knowing your location thanks to your smartphone, you can also make a link in between these environmental parameters like air, soil, and water composition, and the personal risk factor. So, but how to achieve that? Well, the first thing to say is that to achieve the use of all this sensor information in the combat against cancer, you need to dispose of a huge database of all these records of personal measurements for each patient and of environment parameters, and match all of them together in order to produce some meaningful conclusion as to risk factor for a particular person. And the third thing to notice is that to achieve this goal, we need really huge computational power and huge storage power. There was a talk yesterday by a speaker who indicated that for storing one genome, for example, now you need something like 1 terabyte. If you want to store the genome of a population or all newborn persons in a country like France, the order of magnitude of information that you have to process per year is the exabyte, 1 million terabytes. Of course, is out of reach of most hospital budgets, of most country budgets, including developed countries. So how can we achieve this? Well, this goal, and what will be the economical model behind this need for better health, disposing of this huge infrastructure? And that is my question, and is health the next cash cow of IT companies? And that's, I think, is a very relevant question that we should ask ourselves today. Challenges with sensors now. Well, the first challenge, I think, is with data quality. It's not just one thing is to collect all of this information from your smartphone, from all the different sensors. But then, if the collection is not well established, if it is not well annotated, if the person, the patient who is collecting this information does not do it in the proper way, it will be, like the proper say, garbage in, garbage out. So we have to educate patients to use them, and also to train physicians to be able to interact with patients as to data quality. Second problem is deals with the issue of privacy of the information, and there has been a lot of concern about making personal information public, but I think mindsets are evolving now in most countries. In France, for example, it would be very difficult to impose people to share information, and in many European countries it's exactly the same. And law already also has to evolve to enable this collection. And I'll be back to this question a bit later. But then there are also some analytical challenges. If you want to make sense out of all this information, there are several problems which we have to deal with. The first one is known as the curse of dimensionality. I will just give an example with this previous curve I've shown before. If with sensor you can measure millions of variables, you can combine them together, meaning that you have billions and billions of variables. If you have one variable like tobacco consumption and you want to relate it to death by cancer, like on this figure, it's very clear. The picture is clear, there is a clear correlation. If you have billions of variables, just versions, you might find one which will show such a spurious correlation with cancer, but it doesn't mean that it's a causation of cancer. So this question is really a complex question to address in statistics. And another problem with all the sensor information is that, of course, the goal is to improve our ability to detect earlier cancer in order to better treat them. But the risk is to end up with over-diagnosis, meaning that it's known that if you detect earlier, you will detect tumor cells in many cases. And in many cases, they might be treated by the immune system, by their own body, which is, of course, which has defenses against cancer. And if you, there are examples, for example, in thyroid cancer, where habits for detecting cancer cells have been changed. As a result, the number of thyroid cancer has doubled, of detected thyroid cancer has doubled. But in health results, it has not shown anything, meaning that most of them were treated with no reason. And this over-treatment is a direct consequence of over-diagnosis, and this is something we should be prepared to avoid if we go into these sensor-based strategies. So we need for innovative exploration and building tools to make use of all of this information. Now we give a small example of potential of sensors in oncology. Well, first, now it's possible to detect just by analyzing your breath or a drop of blood if you carry a mutation which is linked to a cancer with a very portable, low cost, and simple to use device that can be used in a doctor's office. You know, it's not yet widespread, but it's something which is possible. But one other aspect of sensor in oncology is monitoring, surveillance, and treatment of patients. You know, one of the problems of doctors is to know what their patients are doing when they're not in the office of the doctor. Are they following the treatment? Do they take their pill? Do they forget about it? And on the other hand, the problem of the patient is often when he's not with the doctor, well, I have secondary effect to my treatment, what should I do? Should I wait? Should I see my family doctor? Should I go to the hospital? What should I do? And one thing we developed, a colleague of mine developed in PURI, is an application, a smartphone application, which deals with this question. So you just describe your symptoms, and depending on the symptoms, you fall within one of these boxes, either green, you can stay at home, you are safe, there is no need to go to the doctor. Orange, you should see your family doctor, and red, you should go to hospital. So this enables to sort out the important cases versus the less important cases. And it's already putting some responsibility and some management in the hands of the patient, and it's very useful. So which model do we end with the approach to sensor in technology? Well, the model is this one with patients. Do I have a pointer? No pointer. Oh, no matter. Well, first, the patient itself. With sensor, you can measure many parameters. These parameters, thank you. And these parameters are. This is parameters, once measures give a digital representation of the patient that we can describe as a patient digital avatar. And similarly, the physician also has at his disposal many different algorithms for analyzing information, that's a digital physician. And then there are two or three different modes of functioning. One mode of functioning is to have digital patients or digital physicians working together with no intervention of the physician itself, nor of the patient. Like, you know, these automatic devices that can release, that are implanted into your body and can release some drug depending on measured parameters from your body. So no intervention, no human intervention. Of course, it's limited to some particular cases. The second case is where the patient is interacting with the digital physician directly without any human physician and decide himself about which test to do. Well, it's difficult to implement, of course, and probably not a good thing for security reasons and for efficiency reasons. And the last, in my opinion, the best way of what we should achieve is when patient and physician develop this relationship together with the help of this digital physician or digital avatar, which enrich this relationship. Just as I said before, because when you are not in the office of your doctor, you can still follow what you are doing, and you can still get advice from a good authority in medicine. To achieve that, what we need is a population database of shared records across the population. Population being analyzed with sensors can contribute to this database and has to sharing this information. As I said before, there have been some privacy issues, but you see clearly that if you want to benefit from the system of the patient, well, everybody has to contribute to the system. And the way you can contribute is to put your data at the disposal of the owners within this database. Of course, it has to be secure, it has to be anonymous, and so on, but it's something we should enable. Also, to be able to compute efficiently risk factors in cancer, we know that we need to have generalized database of environment sensor measures, like air composition, soil composition, as we have seen yesterday, and so on. And also knowledge base, all the medical literature about cancer and other diseases. And these will provide also a very valuable tool for the research community to analyze and to increase our knowledge and also to improve algorithms for making a better prediction out of digital data. So I'm almost done. So take a message. Well, there is no one single strategy which can defeat cancer. There needs to be a combination strategy, but I think sensor in oncology can increase a lot our ability to deal with this disease at many different levels. First, at the prevention level, that's the main one I've been exposing today. It's not my specialty, I'm not an epidemiologist, but it's something which can bring the best results in terms of saving lives at the level of the community. In terms of diagnostic, it's already a rarity to have these portable diagnostic tools which you can use in the office of your doctor, and also for treatment monitoring. So the main thing it will change, I think, is it will modify drastically the medical practices. In particular, it will change the way you can have access to medicine, And all these algorithms I mentioned before are fundamentally different from what exists today. In the doctor today, his main algorithm is decision tree. So if you have this, you should do that, then you will do this test. If this test is positive, you will do that. And if not, you will do that. These algorithms I'm talking about, either they're based on modeling, like system logic prior modeling, or statistical learning, but in most cases it's very complex algorithms, and it's not something you can explain easily to a patient, and probably not to a doctor either. So really it will require a new training, a new development of a new specialty for medicine. The challenges include building all these avatars I mentioned before, training patients and physicians, as I just said, structure for storage and compilation, and the matching organization at the level of the health system of the country, and keeping medicine human, keeping the relationship between the patient and the doctor, the essential part of medicine is this relationship, and privacy issues, and avoiding ever treatment, as I said before. So if you are interested in these challenges, and if you want to innovate in this domain, please join us. We're always looking for young talents in that field. So I would like to say a few persons from my lab contributed to this work by discussion with me. Nadine and Fabien in particular are epidemiologists, so very sensible to these questions. And Romain Bossier is a medical doctor, an oncologist, surgeon. André is always interesting to discuss with. François Figo is a former head of the National Institute of Cancer, who developed his vision of personalized medicine in France. And Stephen Friend did a sabbatical in the lab this year, and many of his talks inspired, and discussion inspired this presentation. So thank you for your attention.